How are you, my love?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm very well. Excited to hear about what you have to share.
Okay.
Yeah,
I have a question because you posted this amazing article about the grain of sand.
Okay, yes.
Did you read my comment I did on in the forum? Okay, maybe I know it's too much things happening. So I just wanted to share this because I had a session, my first session with Jeremy when I just started doing sessions, right? And he was the second or something. So the only thing he saw was he was a grain of sand.
I remember your comment now, yes.
Yes, and so we both thought we failed, you know, because I didn't know how to deal. I was a beginner. He couldn't connect with the higher self. And then you post this amazing article and I read it and I was like, oh my God. Oh my God. And I just shared it with him straight away. And it was very profound. And he just told me that he wants to thank you for bringing this message through.
Thank you so much.
Because it made so much sense for him, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, these things come to me when I am not doing anything really. You know, when I go into these deep thinking modes, you know, looking for ways to explain things or ideas, then it just takes one word and a whole story can just download.
Okay, so that's how it came. It was just like a kind of like a download.
Yes.
And I love the way you write, Chrysilla. You're so talented. You should write more.
I really enjoy writing because when I have time to just take my time to do things, it's as if I have a better way of expressing myself, because I really struggle to express myself vocally.
Yes.
So I love writing, and doing the articles with Candace, the editing has really helped me so much to do more of that.
Yeah.
So I'll definitely be writing a lot more, so thank you very much for that.
Yeah, I mean, you have amazing talent in writing, really.
Thank you.
I love reading everything you write. I just enjoy it so much. Such a beauty.
Yeah, and I do read all of your comments. So when you said about Jeremy, I remember I remembered you wrote about it and your session. Well, you know, we all have to start somewhere, and even if we feel it's a failure, it's never a failure. You always learn something from it.
Yeah, so sometimes it just takes time.
I know.
Yeah.
So, welcome to Stargate To Source. I'm Chrysilla Lewies, and this is Hara Katsiki. And we're going to be talking about your trip to Bolivia.
Bulgaria.
Bulgaria? It's not Bolivia?
No.
You went to Bulgaria?
Yes.
Tell me about it. How did it come about, you going to Bulgaria?
So that came from a woman I know there. I was in Sofia in Bulgaria 2 years ago, and I met her, and I told her about what I do. She asked me what am I doing in life. I told her about quantum healing, and I kind of planted a seed, I think, in her, and she was very interested. She asked me back then many questions, and she wanted to have a session with me, but there was no time. And then she said, maybe I come to Berlin. She got busy, I got busy, and she contacted me again 2 years later, so like in the winter. And she said, hey, listen, I'm thinking to invite you to Sofia because I'm very interested to have in having a session. And I have many, many people who are interested as well. And I said, okay, let's talk about it. And she told me she has a dozen of people. And I said, okay, I can do 8 sessions because I have also stuff to do here in Berlin. So we planned the trip, and she planned 8 sessions for me with different people and different individuals. her included. So yeah, and I was there two weeks ago. Yeah, and I had like a marathon of sessions, one per day, which is not usual for me. I usually have, you know, one every 2 days or so. So that was also for me very like, wow, I learned a lot, and it was very, challenging and amazing experience. And yeah, that's how it came about.
The lady had loads of friends, and she brought you over, and it was just a marathon of sessions. And I know that you have some miraculous things that have happened in those sessions that you'd like to share with us. I think it's incredible that if someone can do the work and arrange for a week of sessions to take place, especially in a place where you don't have the quantum healers to do sessions in your area, to bring one over, you know, using that initiative, it's just incredible. I feel like there are many of us that would be willing to do that, just like you did. So it must have been an amazing experience. Have you ever been there before?
Yeah, I was there 2 years ago, shortly. That's how I met her. And I, like I said in the beginning, I shortly introduced what I'm doing to her. And there are no practitioners in Bulgaria. There are no people who are doing this kind of work. And the medical system, as they explained to me, is very conservative, very like old-fashioned, you know, like very like heavy clinical Western medicine. And even the technology they have is very, is not advanced. So there are so many people who are waking up, you know, and they are looking for holistic approaches, for alternative approaches of healing. And there are not so many people there who are doing this kind of stuff. So when C started, I guess, to talk about what I do, there were like so many people who were interested. And I, like I said, I had 8 sessions because that's all I could do at this time. But there were many more who see they were on in already like who would like to have a session, and I will have to go again. And also I was talking with people, you know, because I was also going out in the evenings and meeting people, friends and of hers and other people, talking about what we do. And they would get interested immediately and they would want a session. And I was like, wow, I was so amazed, and I was so happy actually to see the open-mindedness, you know, of this kind of people. Because also Bulgaria, you know, has been suppressed so much with communism, and people are like breaking out of this conservative cell now. And as the land is very strong in Bulgaria, there is lots of thermal sources, lots of water, it's very volcanic, it's lots of crystals. So I think this is all these things, you know, are being activated and are activating people's consciousness. And so it was great to be there and plant some seeds and you know, like work with some people. And I worked with people that are in I guess not a coincidence, with many of these people have kind of like key roles in the Bulgarian society, whether in politics or in social media or in entertainment or in like pharmaceutical industry. So I get goosebumps. So I guess there was a purpose behind everything that happened. Everything was orchestrated divinely for this session to line up for me. And I'm going to share some stories briefly. And I have there was a lot of physical healing that occurred. And I do see physical healing occurring in my sessions generally, but this time was in big scale. It was there were many different ones and really beautiful to see it happening. So I'm gonna start by the first one that I want to talk about. It was a young woman in her 30s. So the story goes like this. This woman was very interested to have a session, but she didn't speak English well. And my friend who organized the sessions said to me that she would like to have a session, but she needs a translator because she cannot speak English. So I have heard, and I guess you have probably heard from Dolores and many other practitioners saying that, no, you shouldn't do a session with the translator. These sessions are like very intimate and private, and it's not good to have a translator in between. And I mean, anyway, that's what I have heard. And so my first reaction was no translator. If she can speak like everyday English, doesn't have to be scientific. Just like enough to have a conversation, that's good enough. So because he wanted to have a session, I guess he said yes. Okay, so we meet and I start to talk to her, and she basically cannot say a word in English, right? And that was for me, it was like, oh, okay, that doesn't work. I mean, how are we going to have a session if you cannot communicate to me? You know, how are we going to do that? And I said to her, okay, you know what, let's just, we were down somewhere with several other people before we have the session. I said to her, let's go up in my room where we're going to do the session and just connect a little bit. Just to be, you know, me and you, and see what is possible. So we go up, we sit across each other, cross-legged on the bed that we would have the session. And I said to her, okay, I'm going to start talking to you. You can slowly, let loose and just start speaking. So I start to talk a bit, ask her some very simple questions. She was just looking at me. She was not able to speak. And
did she understand, though?
That's what I asked. I said to her, do you understand me when I'm talking to you? She's like, she was nodding. She said, yes, I understand. No, speak. I said, all right. So at that moment, I think I was a bit confused. I didn't know how to proceed. What do I do, you know? We were supposed to have the session in half an hour to start the session that was planned, that she had already paid and, you know, invested money, time and energy to do that. So I was like, oh my God, what am I going to do, you know? How am I going to deal with this now? But we're looking at each other's eyes. And I just sit there in silence, just connecting heart to heart with her, looking in her eyes. And as soon as we do that, this wave of emotion rising from both sides, mm-hmm. so huge, so powerful. And we both start crying without words. And she says to me in English, she says to me, I trust you. Please help me. I was like, okay, wow. Because until that time, my mind was like, yeah, I think it's not possible to have this session, you know? So she says that to me. It goes right in deep inside my heart. And then I ask Dolores directly because I like to, get advice from her often. And so I say, Dolores, I know we are not supposed to do sessions with translators. Please tell me, what should I do now? She's like, go for it. She's ready. And I said, okay, how? Ask her best friend to translate this, to be there as a translator. I said, is that okay? It's perfectly okay. Just do it now. Go for it. So I was like, okay. I said to her, let's go down. We found her best friend. I asked her if she can do that for us. And she said yes. And so we start the session. So I was speaking to her in English. She would understand. She would reply in Bulgarian and her friend would translate in English. And then I would continue. So during the pre-talk, she had a list of questions that were about her relationships with friends and family and her career and stuff like this. But I could sense an underlying block, big, big emotional block. I could sense it. So I have Dolores on my right side telling me, ask her about her childhood. Ask her more information about her childhood. Okay. So I start to ask her more about her childhood. She was a bit reluctant in the beginning. She didn't want to share much. So I could feel that, okay, we have to dig there. There is something there, you know. So Dolores was asking more, more, more. And so I was like digging. And then she's mentioned the father at some point, and then Dolores says, ask about him. There is something there. Okay, so I asked to ask her more questions about the father. And I realized there was some kind of a block there. So I said to her, there was something unresolved there. And I could feel the emotion rising more and more. And I said to her, how about if we bring him forth? He passed away. He has already passed away. I just said intuitively, how about if you want to, you know, resolve the situation and bring him through during the session? And she immediately burst into tears. I knew I had, you know, hit the right string. So we go, she agrees. We start the session. It was very interesting for me to have a session with the translator. It worked incredibly good. I mean, there was, you know, all the doubts I had, my conscious mind thinking, oh my God, how is this going to work? Is it going to be complicated? No. Smooth. And everything was rolling, like it was like flowing. And so going to the most important part. So during the higher self, the part, the second part, the father comes through. And so what comes through is that the father had had cancer while she was in her adolescent. He had cancer he was the cancer was getting worse and worse, and he was like, nothing could be done. He was basically dying. And so he, at the end, they had hooked him up with a machine for breathing. And something happened there, and something needed to be changed. And the girl, the woman I had the session with, something happened there, and she did a mistake of what she thought was a mistake. So either she didn't reactivate the machine or she unplugged it, resulting in her dad's death, yeah. Right? So what we found out during the session is that she was carrying for 15 years the guilt of feeling, of thinking that she killed her father. And want, you know, not, of course she didn't meant to, but that it was her mistake, so to say, that she was responsible for her dad's death. The father came in and he gave a very loving, very clear and very simple and short message saying, I forgive her for what happened. And I only want to thank her because I wanted to go. I needed to go. This machine was just torturing me, and she set me free. So she can also be free of guilt. And what was the healing about? So the healing was that since then she had a massive lump on her right collarbone. you could see it physically with the naked eye. It was a very big lump. The doctors didn't know what it is, couldn't find what it was. And it was hurting her constantly for 15 years. Constant pain. The release of the guilt healed her instantly during the session. She felt immediately a relief from the pain. And she's since then pain-free. And that was for me, wow, like really, really amazing. When the guilt was released, the higher self immediately sent light in her body and healed this part. And yeah, she had instant release, which she woke up from the hypnosis, almost couldn't believe that it was gone.
So what I read from that is the right-hand side is the masculine part of when we do healing, right? Left hand is feminine, right hand is masculine. She was carrying something on her shoulder, so that would have been, you know, carrying a burden. That is where we normally, if things get too heavy for us, right, this is where it lies. And it being on this side, the left hand side is just, or the right hand side is showing that that is where she was storing the guilt, right?
Yeah,
a perfect example of how our emotions affect us physically.
Mm-hmm. You know what I did after all the sessions, understand through the communication with the higher self the cause of the issue of the physical manifestation of the illness or disease or whatever that is, and then we go to the healing. There's this book, Soul Speak, is written from the daughter of Dolores.
Oh yeah, I've got the Metaphysical Anatomy.
yes. And I guess, I mean, this book talks about the secret language of the body, and that the messages that our physical bodies are basically delivering to us. So every ache and every pain is the body delivering a message to us, that wants to get understood. And once this message is understood, which can be done through hypnosis, where you can connect with the subconscious, the higher self, or the higher self. Once this is understood and acted upon, there is no longer need to deliver this message from the body, and so the symptoms are gone, and because there's no need for it. Because I had some. I'm going to talk about another one with the beautiful physical healing. So I went after I had, you know, this notes from my sessions. I went to this book just to have a reference of what Dolores was finding, because this book is from her daughter, and she kind of like wrote like a, yeah, like a, from Dolores's thousands of sessions and that she found a pattern. Which is, of course, not always the case, but there was like lots of.
Just for clarification, there for you, Hara, and for everyone watching, when you speak about Dolores there guiding you, if no one is familiar with Dolores Cannon, she is the renowned hypnotherapist of QHHT and the creator of QHHT. And when she passed over, we know that she still works very closely with us as practitioners. So when Hara mentions Dolores, Dolores is very much a guide within our sessions. Yeah, just had to say that. So,
thank you. Yes, thank you so much for that. And yeah, so I went through that book just to see, you know, if there's any similarity or so. And yeah, there was actually. She had found in her sessions that the arms, the hands, and the shoulders hold on to things and people. And they don't want to let, it's like the body's telling you that you don't want to let go of something, you know? So in that case was the guilt. Wow. Yeah. I get goosebumps. Yes.
Wonderful. Yeah. Mm. So a learning experience, having a translator in there, and everything worked out. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, exactly. I just also wanted to say to, this is also a message for the people, for practitioners and for people who want to have these journeys, that from, I have discovered, like with this case now with the translators and different other cases, I think we should let go of rules and shoulds, and if you're ready, if you feel like doing a session in any way, just go for it, because if you're ready, I think everything will line up and the magic will happen.
Yeah, no, if you know, if there's a will, there's a way, especially if you are open-minded enough and you have that intention for it to work, you know, and you're open-minded for whatever to unfold, then there's possibilities are endless. But tell me, Hara, about, you know, the people you met on this journey. How open-minded were they with regards to this inner journey exploration and potentially going into past lives? How did you explain to them what quantum healing hypnosis is?
So my experience was very mixed, because of the people that were very mixed, in the sense that some were already aware of the, you know, they could follow and understand the concept and of what we were we were supposed to do, and some were completely oblivious. Some had almost no idea of what it's all about, but they just believed that it's, you know, it's a certain form of healing, and they just wanted that, and they trusted, I guess, that as a process. So I had to deal with them individually, in you know, differently. So I would, you know, I usually try to adapt to people's level of consciousness.
Yes.
And communicate with them appropriately. So sometimes I would just talk very in simple words, you know, like if you would talk to a child in a way, you know, just very simple, not complicated stuff, just talking about the power of the mind and, you know, letting go and allowing yourself to, you know, to relax and dive deep inside, and there you're gonna find that all the answers lie within. Just very simple things, talking more about the subconscious. And in other cases, yeah, I would, you know, we would just go deeper into the subject and with more advanced concepts and ideas. But generally, I found people very open to this work. And I don't know, maybe, I don't know if you have similar experiences, but sometimes people who are not into this field, into the metaphysical or spiritual field, you know, they're just open-minded or anything like that. They have really profound sessions because they have no expectations. They don't know what to expect, you know. That's and true. They just go and they get the information pure, unfiltered.
Yeah. Yeah, I've had an experience with regards to a lady who wanted to have a session, and it's normal to have questions with regards to how deep you can take me. How deep can you take me? I want to have a profound experience. So I guess my example is about expectations and how you spoke about meeting the person on their level, right? Because that is how you will work within each session. You will meet a person at their level and take it from there. So with regards to this client, you know, how deep can you take me? Well, how deep do you want to go? How deep would you allow yourself to go? Well, I want to experience the deepest states of trance. Well, then please leave all expectations out the door and just come in with an open mind. And we will allow you to go to the deepest states of trance. But did you have anyone that you weren't able to hypnotize? you know? And then there's all these critical questions, all these, well, what if, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And those are the type of sessions that will completely block the end result, the experience of having the ultimate inner journey with regards to, because you're consciously going to say to yourself, you know, am I deep enough? Can I go deeper? That analytical mind will be talking to you and chattering throughout the session. So, yeah, I totally agree with you. No expectations. What's this all about? I want to be healed. I want to find out the answers with regards to where I'm stuck, what I need to do. And if there isn't this idea of what it should be like, then you don't have that end goal, right, of saying, it needs to be this way. Why is my session not going this way? Why am I not having the experience that person has had, depending on the research that I've done? Because everyone is so different. Everyone will have a different experience. And therefore, you just cannot, you cannot compare yourself to anyone else.
Yeah. I like to say to people before the session, after we have talked about all the things they want to, you know, they want to get answers for during the session and everything, I take the list of the questions away, I put it on the side, and I say, okay, now forget about everything. Forget about everything we talked about. Forget about who you are. Forget about your character in this life. Forget about everything. Erase everything. Imagine that we are just going to start painting a canvas from scratch, just a white canvas. Okay, can you do that? Can you merge with this idea? Yeah, okay, you know, and then yeah. Metaphors often help people.
Metaphors are amazing. They always help people because it kind of opens the mind a little bit, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Watching things from a different perspective. Tell us about the other sessions you had, because I know there's some exciting things you'd like to share.
Yeah, so another one that was also including physical healing was another woman in her 30s also. Her main issue, I would say, was the fact that her father abandoned the family when she was very, very young. And so she grew up without him. And she kind of never got over it. And also, there was a little bit of a confusion or a big question mark for her, because there was a neighbor that she was thinking that it, maybe it's him actually, but he never admitted it. And then he even asked him to make a DNA test to check for her to check if he's the father. And he did the test, the guy, and he said to her that, no, I'm not your father. But she didn't believe him. So she wanted, through the session, to find the answer. And the answer was that, yes, it was him. And he was just also guilty to say that it was him, because he abandoned her, basically. And so, of course, I asked the higher self, why did she choose to have this experience? And they said that she wanted to grow up more free, with less control. And so what she had trapped in her body was a lot of sorrow, a lot of anger. And she also had hyperthyroidism, which had developed into Hashimoto for many years. So that was really holding her down in her life. And so she trapped all these emotions, and there was a lot of trapped in the thyroid. And because she thought she didn't deserve the love of her father, so she had a lot of failure and fear in that area, that she wasn't good enough. And And then of course we released that trapped emotions. She understood that this wasn't serving her. There was an amazing energy that came through when I asked for healing, I could feel it in my whole body. I was literally shaking through the healing portion of the session. Really, like, I felt like I'm being plugged in a fuse. It was just so powerful. And during the healing, it lasted a little bit, five minutes, more or less. As I'm observing, as I'm witnessing the healing, I got a message which said to me, make a video. Grab your smartphone and make a video now. And I didn't question it. I just grabbed my mobile and I made a short video, which I listened to after the session. And to my surprise, what I found out in the video was that my voice was normal, as we can hear it now, and her voice, because of the high energy that was coming through her from the healing, the voice was completely distorted. So you hear my voice in that video normal, then you hear her voice completely distorted, and then I'm continuing talking with a normal voice. And this is like a one minute video, and I have it ready. Should I share it now?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Why not? Okay.
Why not?
Mm-hmm. Very good. Is it working?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. Very good. So yes, that was for me a proof of the energy that came through in the session that was so powerful that it affected the audio.
So let's explain. So what happened was you were guided to record as she was speaking, as she was under hypnosis, right? So she was talking to you and you were guided to record her. And as you recorded her, you could hear her fine, everything was perfect, as a session should be. But after the session and after reviewing the audio, everything was distorted because of the amount of energy that was in the room, right? So that is the video clip that we will be sharing, or that will be posted below in the video. But it just shows you how amazing the energy can build within a room, and how that is how the healing takes place, but how the spirit world as well work with us as practitioners, guide us, like Dolores would be working with you and guide you to say, you know, take this video. I think the energy created on the other side, or I mean the other side in a way that we can't see, but we can feel it, it's just incredible.
Yeah, and it was a proof for me and for her. You know, because I mean, we are human. We also, you know, this is like this instantaneous healings are also challenging our belief system. Even if we believe in this work and we do this work, every time it happens, it's really like breaking down all the unconscious belief systems that we have been bombarded since we were born. This is a miracle. This is magic. This, you know, like this spontaneous transmission that the doctors talk about. It's possible. So it was for me also very powerful confirmation. And for her, I send it to her, and I think I get goosebumps. I think it helped her conscious mind also, you know, like accept it and manifest it.
Especially when you understand why things happened in the first place, right?
Yeah. And yeah, and then after all this, I went again to this book I saw before. with the secret
soul speak.
The soul speak, yeah.
Or was your travel companion?
No. This I did after when I came back in Berlin, just to, you know, just to see the if there were any similarities. And again, there was the thyroid problems, as Dolores Cannon had found out, is the fear that you have to what you have to say is not important. So in her case, it was the fear of that yes, it was not good enough to deserve her father's love. So,
initially, you know, even though she felt like that being here in the earth plane, unconsciously, subconsciously, you know, that is what she wanted when she incarnated. She didn't want to be controlled, right?
Yeah. Exactly. So we turned it upside down. It was wonderful, yeah. I have another story from the trip that it has to do with ancestral trauma, with family trauma, and it's a personal story because it involves me. So the story goes like this. I will make it short. In December 2018, so several months ago, I had a dream, and I have often prophetic dreams, powerful dreams, which I'm working with them now, understanding them more and more. So I had that dream and I saw my grandma almost dying. So I woke up in the morning, I was very, you know, shocked, upset and worried. So first thing, I call her to check on her. She said she's fine. I was like, okay, good. So I kept calling her once per week for several weeks just to check on her, because the dream was so strong, you know. So I still had a little bit of worry that, you know, if everything was fine with her. So for a few weeks, she was like, she was saying she was fine. So I kind of said, okay, maybe it was just a nightmare, or, you know, I dismissed it. But in beginning of, so like a month, one and a half month later, she started to have an issue. She started to grow on her throat a lump, which was growing and growing and growing. And it became about this size. Coming out, I didn't see it, but she was describing it for me. It started to change color. It started to become from pink to purple to, like, very nasty. And so
this is your grandmother?
Mm-hmm. Yes, my grandmother. So the mother of my mother. So they had to finally take her to the doctor. And to the hospital and check on her. So, okay. I knew what it was. Don't ask me how. I knew. My intuition. I knew what it was. I knew that this is a tumor. That is a form of cancer. We have heard many times that anger is that cancer is a form of unexpressed anger. We manifest into cancer. Many practitioners find this out in their sessions. I knew that this was a tumor, and that was anger, unreleased anger from an ancestral trauma that has been that happened one generation before hers. And I will go into that in a moment. But because I knew when she, you know, when she said that what's going on to her, I immediately called my mom and I said to her, please take her to the hospital as soon as possible. She was like, yeah, we went to this doctor and they gave her this antibiotic. And I was like, no antibiotics. Take her to the hospital and make a biopsy. And my mom was like, biopsy? Why? What do you suggest? That it's a tumor? You're negative and you are pessimistic and you are, you're very fearful and it's okay. You don't have to worry. It's going to be fine. I was like, mom, please listen to me and take her for a biopsy. Anyway, it took 1 month in back and forth in the hospital doing different kinds of tests, all the stupid tests you can imagine. I was quite angry with the medical system, you know, because they just want to waste your time and just make more and more tests just to make more and more money. And they were draining her energy through the process. So finally they made a biopsy and guess what? It was a tumor, right? And so they planned the surgery. They planned the surgery. It went March already that they found out that it's a tumor and they had to make a surgery. So they planned the surgery for April. April was the time I went to Sofia in Bulgaria. So how is this all connected? The story goes like this. It's an incredible story. The father of my grandmother, the one that had the tumor, so her father, my grandfather, when he was 15 years old, he was living in north of Greece at that time. That was in the 1931 or something like that. So that was after the First World War. There was a lot of trouble between Greece and Bulgaria. The Bulgarian army, a part of them, invaded Greece, and molested people, they burned villages, they killed people, they stole their gold, whatever money they had. So they abused my grandfather physically. They actually wanted to kill him. They didn't manage to kill him. They thought they did, but he got saved finally. So, but he, because of the abuse, he became blind. And he was blind for the rest of his life. He never saw me. I met him, but he couldn't see me. He was blind. But so he was carrying this anger with him all this time. My grandma grew up with him. She took over the anger from him, the unreleased anger from him, right? So I knew that this is an ancestral trauma connected to what happened back then. The night before I go to Bulgaria, I have a dream again, very vivid dream. I'm in a room with my grandfather and my grandmother. And I approach my grandfather and he gives me a golden ring with a precious stone. And he says to me, this is my gift to you because of your help, because of what you are about to do for me and for our family. And I want to thank you for that. This is my reward to you. And I love you dearly. And the same, I looked at my grandma. She was sitting next to him. She gave me a bracelet, a golden bracelet with stones also, with the same message. I woke up in the morning and I had to take a coffee and leave to go to Bulgaria, to the airport, for the sessions that we were talking about. Before I had almost even forgotten the dream about, I just started to get very emotional and very anxious. I started shaking, I couldn't breathe, I started crying. I felt like having like a little panic attack. I felt like, I don't know, I just felt like so much anxiety, and I felt like, oh my God, I don't feel well. I cannot go, I cannot do this. Suddenly everything became overwhelming. I was not understanding what's going on. And then I'm like, oh my God, I had a dream. Then I remember the dream, and I remember my grandfather giving me this gift and everything. And then I get this instant download. My higher self says to me, you are going there not only for the sessions, but you're going there to clear the ancestral trauma from your family. And I'm like, what? How? What do you mean? They're like, you're going to meet a person there that you're going to have a session with, that his family was involved in that incident. And through the session, through the unconditional love and the compassion that you're going to hold for him in the session, the trauma and the karma will be released. I was like, wow. And then I was shaking even more. I was like, oh my God. So, and I was said, okay, I asked, what am I supposed to do? You know, what should I do? And they said to me, there's nothing you need to do. This will happen in a way automatically. How to say that? It will just happen. You're just going to meet that person, and through the exchange of the energy, this mechanism is going to fire up and unfold without you needing really to put action on it further. And just be open, just be, you know, like you always are, hold the space for these people who will come to you unconditionally, and it's going to be done. I was like, okay. So to me, I go there, I do my sessions, and at the last day of before I leave Bulgaria, I receive a message from my higher self which says, mission complete. The trauma has been released. The healing and ancestral healing has been done. I was very excited about that. And now the last detail, which is also amazing, is that my grandma had the initial surgery before I go to Bulgaria to remove the tumor. And so while I was in Bulgaria, she was recovering. But they had done before after the surgery, they had done a test directly after the surgery to see the situation, how it was after the surgery. And they said they would give her the results in a couple of days later. So while I was in Bulgaria, I talked with my mom, and she said that the results, the doctor said that there are still some cancerous cells. And so they had to operate her again. And of course, everybody was devastated because they couldn't go through this again, you know. And, but my higher self, after this, that was like, it was like a stasis, a time of them waiting to prepare for the second surgery. That would be a few days ago. So in that time frame, I did the sessions in Bulgaria. I helped with cleansing the ancestral trauma. And then my higher self said, she doesn't need a second surgery anymore. Whatever was there is been healed. She's clean. So, and I knew that they had planned a second surgery because of the results that the test they did before I go to Bulgaria. And guess what happened? They had planned the surgery on Wednesday, 4 days ago. And I called my mom to ask her what's going on. They put her in the hospital, and they did a test, the doctors, before they operated her for the second time. And guess what they said? They said, we don't know what happened, but she doesn't need a second surgery anymore. She's clean.
Wonderful. Whew. Well, you were truly guided, and what miraculous, right? Tell me about how you believe ancestral trauma is transferred. That's a very fascinating subject. I love ancestral trauma with regards to how it takes place, how we take on the energy of our ancestors, because it needs to be cleared. So there will be this transference that will take place.
Okay, I'm going to be honest. I don't know much about it. I have never really studied it, you know, in a sense, or read about it, you know. But I would just share my thoughts on this, which is something new for me. I also, it never really came up in my sessions that much so far. But what I understood through my personal experience going through that is that sometimes there's such a big trauma in a person's life, which of course they have chosen to go through. We all know that we are not victims, but however, if there's too much trauma and the person is not able to resolve it in the current life that he's going through it, if they are, this person might even get, actually they don't even cross over to the other side, they get trapped in this realm. Because they are, you know, they are not light enough. They still carry this in their shoulders, way holding them down. So they even like get trapped in this. Perhaps in many cases, they might even get trapped in this realm, in our 3D world, in the physical. So what I understand from that concept is that the generations ahead. Perhaps in some cases there might be some people after that they might be strong enough to, because they are connected, you know, they are family, they are connected. So maybe there are souls in the generations ahead who might help clear up this family karma, because it's a group. We are a group. We have agreed to connect in a very strong way through the blood and through the yes. So that's all I'm you know, I can say about that. But perhaps why don't you share your insights?
Okay, so what I have found with regards to trauma can happen in many ways. Well, if you look, the first instance of trauma could be if you look at two generations back, because when grandmother carried, or even when grandmother experienced trauma within a life, she had your mum within her, and you would already be within mum. So it's as if, even though you weren't a thought yet to be conceived, you were still, the eggs were still there in the womb already. So whatever trauma took place there, that would take on within the cells, within the body, right? So when I look at trauma, I would always go back to generations because of that fact. Other parts of trauma could take place when you simply just observe something traumatic. Let's say, for example, you're driving down the road and someone jumps in front of the car. Just that traumatic experience of maybe what went through the person who was jumping in front of the car, you could be taking on all of their trauma in that single moment, right? And you wouldn't think of it like that at all. But when you go back and investigate, that is when a traumatic event experienced is taken on, especially when things start to manifest physically and you want to find the healing or the core of it, right? So just by watching things could be a transference of a traumatic experience, especially when you experience something where something triggered it. If you look at allergies, for example, you know, the easy example that I could use is if something traumatic happened, you felt a certain feeling, let's say you're allergic to cats and there was a cat in the background, your mind noticed the cat while registering the feeling of the traumatic experience, and then there you go, there's an allergic reaction. So every time your body feels this threat, it will come up. Or every time your body comes near a cat, your body would say, I need to protect this person right now. The allergy would activate. So there's various ways that trauma can be transferred. And and stored within the body. You know, you may be feeling something that's not yours, or something may have happened within your life that has triggered something and you don't know what it was. You could have a fear of drowning or fear of water, but you've never had that experience. Again, it could be an ancestral event where someone in the family had that experience and it was transferred to you. Yeah, that's a basic, just basic example, an explanation of what I can tell you about trauma transfer. Mm. Yeah.
So do you think that we volunteer to carry on, to take on this karma, this trauma, sorry?
Well, I think in many cases we have agreed to take on and resolve this trauma, mm-hmm. especially with regards to how we are now moving into accelerated times, trying to increase the planetary vibration as well as our own vibration and frequency. So, yes, some of it is us taking on that decision to resolve ancestral trauma. But in other cases, some of it is very involuntary, you know, that our body is just trying to protect us in a sense of, you know, having this fight or flight reaction, having those feelings come up, you know, because that's our nature. That is how the reptilian mind protects us, by those reactions, fight, flight, hide. You know, what do you want to do to survive? And many times there's also conflict of instincts, right? Do you freeze and want to run at the same time? And that could cause a problem within the body that may rise to anxiety and all sorts of other things that could come up. Yeah. It's fascinating. The body is complex. I think that even though we want to say that we are very intelligent, sometimes that's not the case with regards to our body functions or our mind, you know, because in many cases we're not back in the day when we had to fight off or run for our lives, when merely you're just going through a stressful day at work and it is survival for you.
Yeah. But what I have discovered is that the the illnesses or the, you know, physical pains or anything that the body manifests through the subconscious mind is actually very literal. Very symbolic.
With things manifesting within the body, for sure. Yeah, because that's the only way the body can communicate with you with regards to what the problem is, right? So have a look at where you're having problems within the body. Like you say, the throat is speaking up for yourself, self-worth. And then if you look at cancer, I know it's a very difficult subject for many, suppressed anger, that's there. Again, look at the side you're having problems with. If it's the left side, have a look to see where there's problems with regards to dad's side of the family, or maybe dad's dad, your grandfather. And the left-hand side would be the feminine side. So that is very significant as well with regards to what's happening. But I know it is easy to say when things manifest physically to... let's say you have a knee problem. Oh, yes, that was from the rugby I played or the football I played, you know. But everything happens for a reason. So, and it's also good to note and to take into consideration that your whole body is made out of a network of not only cells, but it's as if there's this fascia, right, within the body. And if this fascia is damaged, you know, that is a weak spot within the body. So if there's anything emotionally that is going to be stored up, it's automatically going to go to those weaker points within the body that will manifest for you as well. And that will also correlate to with regards to what's happening physically within your life. So knee trouble, you know, are you struggling to step into your power, into your life purpose, or moving forward into doing things that you are avoiding? Yeah. But wonderful. You had amazing sessions. Thank you so much for sharing all of them. Hopefully people will be able to learn from them, take away from them. And yes, do invite us over to your countries if you are willing to get the people, arrange the days. You know, all you have to do is show up and be present there for you in your sessions. Yeah, it sounds like an amazing experience and wonderful for you to do that, Hara.
Yes, thank you so much for watching. Thank you very much for being open to new possibilities.
Yes.
And thank you for the wonderful questions, Chrysilla.
No, you're most welcome. You know, it is intriguing and fascinating to see what other practitioners do and how you may be opening doors to other parts of the world. And that's exactly what you're doing. It's wonderful. And it's like you're planting those small little seeds to just grow and expand outwards.
Yeah, and so yes, I mean, what also I'm discovering through traveling and giving sessions around the world is that we have much more things in common than we think we do. This like collective consciousness, you know, is being evident. When you connect in that level with individuals from all over the world, it's this beautiful union of realizing that we are born in different countries, but we are, you know, we have slightly different ways of behaving perhaps, but the core is the same.
Yes,
it's just love.
That is a beautiful ending and message, because it's so true to the core. Yeah, thank you everyone for watching. It's wonderful having you here. It's wonderful speaking to you, Hara, as always. I love you so much, and I love the stories you share, and having this co-creation with you just excites me every time we can get together and share stories.
Thank you everybody, thank you for watching. Big kisses, much love.